Statistics Unit Section 4. In today's competitive marketplace, businesses and industries know they must provide quality products and services. As part of a bigger quality initiative, businesses often use Statistical Process Control, or SPC. This is a method used to measure, understand, and control variation that occurs in a manufacturing process. There's two areas that this covers, and we'll start out taking a look at the process. If a machine that makes parts is working properly, there should be no surprises in terms of the measurable attributes of the parts produced. It is expected that there will be subtle variations in each item made. The variation found in a process is considered to be normal and a natural thing that cannot be completely eliminated. So if we look at this example here, the process is to cut steel bars to a specified length, and taking some samples, they found the mean to be 5.8 and the standard deviation to be 1/100 of an inch. If we graph that using our normal distribution, this would be our range of values. 99.7% should be 3 standard deviations above the mean and 3 standard deviations below the mean. We refer to these as the upper control limit, which is the 3 standard deviations above, and LCL is short for the lower control limit. A process is in control as long as the values fall between these boundaries. Excessive variations mean that many parts will be made that cannot be used or sold. Let's look at filling some pop bottles. After taking some samples and calculating the following values, we have a mean of 16.2 and a standard deviation of 1/10 of a fluid ounce. To find the upper control limit, or the UCL, we take the mean plus 3 times the standard deviation, and for the lower control limit, we'll take the mean minus 3 times the standard deviation. These two limits combine to give us that 99.7%. And if we plug in the particular values and continue simplifying, we find an upper control limit of 16.5 and simplifying a lower control limit of 15.9. We would expect 99.7, or virtually every or almost every bottle, to be filled between 15.9 and 16.5 ounces. If the output is graphed, it would look like that bell-shaped curve or a normal distribution. And if we fill in the values, the mean would be in the middle, the average 16.2, going out 3 standard deviations above, we have our upper control limit, and 3 standard deviations below is our lower control limit. Any values falling within these boundaries is going to be an in-control process, virtually all. We can take that normal distribution, normally horizontal, and express it vertical, and this gives us what we call a control chart. We turn the measurements from this process into a graph. We have our upper and lower control limits, and a trained worker can read the control chart and interpret what the graph data is communicating about the process. Is it in control or reliable? We can tell, as long as our values are within the boundary of the upper and lower control limits, that this would be an in process. Any manufacturing has a certain amount of variability, and when we have a process that's giving us a value that is perhaps beyond the upper control limit or below the lower control limit, we need to stop the process because of the fact that these control charts are made while the process is occurring. This allows further errors to be avoided and fixing them now rather than later. Values that, or variations that might not be expected, would be a temperature fluctuation, tool wear, changes in humidity, changes in suppliers, where quality might be affected, new workers and a worker error, countless other possibilities where the problem would need to be identified quickly so that further losses aren't incurred. Let's take a look at another example of filling drums with fluid. Samples were taken. Those samples were analyzed, and a mean of 50.1 gallon was found and a standard deviation of 5 hundredths of a gallon. Should be normally distributed if the process is in control, where we have 3 standard deviations above and below is going to give us our 99.7%. And this variation, ideally, perhaps if the gallon says it's 50 gallons, ideally we would want the 50 gallons, but there's normal variation within a process, and this would be acceptable variations. It's when a value falls below or above those 3 standard deviation values that we have an out of control process and need to take a closer look. So again, we take that normal distribution, horizontally bell-shaped, turn it on its side, a 90 degree rotation for a control chart. And every hour or period of time, samples are taken. And here we can see that there was a problem at this third sample interval, that there was something that was not normal variation, and we need to identify what the problem is and correct it. Shifting our view to looking at the tolerance, when we're talking about a tolerance of a product, we're talking about what the product is to be manufactured. The designer of that product furnishes specifications to the people who will be making it. The goal of the manufacturing process is to make the product so that it meets the designer's specification. The designer uses a tolerance to communicate what the critical dimensions will be. And if they meet those qualifications, then the part is approved and will be purchased. So if we look at this example, the manufacturer or designer has a specific tolerance of ideally 5.8 inches, but they will allow a variation or tolerance of 4 hundredths of an inch. So if we add and subtract that tolerance, it gives us our upper tolerance level and our lower tolerance level. And sometimes these are referred to as the maximum and the minimum values. As long as the product through the process is within these two values, the product is judged to be okay. If they're smaller or larger, then it's not going to work. An ideal situation occurs when a process that is in control produces items that are, on average, very close to the ideal specifications set by the product designer. So we put these two ideas together here. We have our control chart, and we want to look at making sure that the tolerances are met with our process. So if here on the right hand side, this is the maximum and minimum, and the process falls within those, and the process, of course, is taking the actual manufactured product, determining the upper and lower control limit. In other words, 99.7% of the products are smaller than the max and bigger than the minimum. Everything is fine. We have some area to vary here. Versus if our process ends up being in this range, in the shaded region, but our tolerance limits are not lining up, this is an indication that we are making things larger than is the maximum amount allowed by the specifications for the product. This would definitely indicate that the process needs to have a close look so that there's no more loss of products not meeting specifications. And to illustrate this, let's look at manufacturing process. Samples were taken, a mean diameter of this part is given with a standard deviation. The manufacturer or the designer has specifications of an ideal measurement of 2.5 inches plus or minus the 15/10,000 of an inch. To find the maximum, we add the tolerance and subtract the tolerance from the ideal measurement. To know whether the process is in control and meeting the specifications of the design, we will graph the ideal measurement, the maximum and minimum. A graph is going to give us a quick visual representation of what's going on. What is the upper and lower control limit for this process? Well, we're going to take the mean, add 3 times the standard deviation for the upper control limit, and take the mean minus 3 times the standard deviation for the lower limit. And then let's graph those compared to the product specifications. The mean diameter is just slightly larger than the ideal, so that looks good. The upper control limit is beyond, if you look at this number, it is beyond the maximum, so there's a problem. We're making parts that are larger than the specifications. And on the lower end, where the bottom of our 99.7% of the actual process is right at the minimum. So we have two areas of concern, making products too large and operating right at the minimum. It'd be much better if this value was slightly larger than the minimum. Here are these values again, just to show you graphically. This is what the process looks like with 99.7% of the values running between the upper and lower control limit that we just saw in the previous slide. And here's where that maximum and minimum values fall. And you can see again, looking at our process compared to our ideal measurement, we are making things larger than we should, and we're operating right at the fringe of acceptance on the lower side. Couple practice examples here. What are the control limits for a process with a mean of 39.7 grams and a standard deviation of 0.2 grams? We'll use our upper and lower control limit formulas by taking the mean plus or minus 3 times the standard deviation to get the 99.7%, and the values you should get are 39.1 for the lower control limit up to 40.3 for our upper control limit. That represents 99.7% of the process is falling within those values. What are the tolerance limits for this part? Ideally 96.55 millimeters plus or minus 0.025 of a millimeter. To find the maximum and the minimum for our tolerance limits, we add the tolerance and subtract the tolerance from the ideal, and the values that you should get are the following. In this third example, a process has a mean of 18.12 inches and a standard deviation of 0.05. The product tolerance is given as ideally 18.15 inch plus or minus 0.1 inch. And the question is, are they doing okay? We need to find the upper and lower control limits to find out where 99.7% of the process is actually producing, and then compare it to the maximum and the minimum values. And here we have the graphs of those, and we can see we're making values that are smaller than they should and values that are larger than they should. Additional practice can be found on page 42.